Welcome, mappers! Today, I'll be teaching you how to make ruined walls in the Perspectives 3 add-on for Campaign Cartographer 3+. As you can see, I've already loaded up a map on my screen. It shows a ruined keep, and as you can see, there are some features here, a ruined walls, a few ruined towers, and so on. And zoom a little bit closer to give a better view of the ruined wall. And such ruined walls gives us two advantages when we try to depict a ruined buildings. First of all, making a building look ruined if all the walls are whole makes really no sense. It's very difficult to depict that this is supposed to be a ruin. And secondly, the hole formed by the ruined walls allows us to see into the building, so we can actually show what happens in the building interior as well. Now, before we start with the tutorial, if you have any comments, feel free to post them below in the YouTube comments. But if you have any problems or questions that require extended discussion, I highly recommend that you go to the ProFantasy community forums instead. I hang out there all the time, and the chances are that you'll get a much quicker and better response if you post the questions there rather than here in the YouTube comments. The URL to the ProFantasy community forums can be found in the video description below. Also, if you prefer to read this tutorial in text form instead, I have a blog article posted, which you can also find the URL for in the video description below. Now, let's get started with the actual map. I'm going to make a new map in the Perspective 3 add-ons. So we make a perspective map. And I'm going for Perspectives Dungeon Bitmap A in this case. I set some appropriate dimensions. Remember that for the Perspectives add-on, by default, this is in feet, unless you choose a metric template. In that case, it will be in meters. So I'm now making a map that is 200 feet wide by 160 feet high. So just make and save that map. And we have a basic map. First things first, I'd like to add a grid. A grid gives me some reference points and helps me draw things later. So I'm going to draw hex or square overlay. I'm gonna make my grid cells 10 feet each for this map. It's an isometric grid, and I don't want any labeling. So apply. I'm also going to turn off the dots. And one issue with the grid is that by default, in the perspective templates, the grid is not frozen, which means when I start working on things, I can accidentally select the grid and risk executing commands on it. I don't want to do that, so I'm going to the layers dialog, and I'm gonna freeze the hex square grid, and now the grid won't be selected when I try to do editing operations. So we won't accidentally have problems with the grid getting in our way. Let's start by drawing a basic wall in Perspectives 3. I want to start by ensuring the wall has the appropriate visual appearance. So I'm going to click Perspective Settings first. And I'm going to pick the Masonry G wall setting. I'm only interested in the wall, not the floor, so I don't care about whatever that looks like right now. Wall looks good. Okay, now we have the wall tool in Perspectives 3. I could just click the tool and draw a wall, but right now it's quite important to me to know exactly the thickness of that wall. And if I right click the wall, I actually have some options. So I'm gonna do a wall choose thickness. I want to make a wall that is 2 foot wide, and right now there is a minor bug with the CC3 plus macro file, which means that this option experience a 1 foot wall. Hopefully that will be fixed soon, but for now I'm just gonna choose thickness, and I'm just gonna type in on the command line 2, it asks for wall width, manually, to get a 2 foot wide wall. Then I can just draw it, clicking, turning on snap first, and clicking on the first end, and then clicking on the second end. I could now continue to make walls by clicking around in the map, but I only want this single wall, so I'm gonna right click to end the command, and it's now going to ask me for the height of the wall. If you look in the command prompt, it suggests a wall height. That's the last number I used. I don't want the wall to be that short. And I could just move my mouse and pick a visual height, but I prefer to just type in the number. In this case, I'm going to type in 25 and make the wall 25 feet tall. It's a nice tall wall. Okay, there we go. We have our wall. So, the next question is, how do we give this the appearance of a ruined wall? Now, this wall is made up of multiple polygons. And if this was just a traditional flat scene from above dungeon map, I would probably go in, do some editing of the polygon, and change it up a bit. But in perspective, there are quite a few complications. First of all, in perspective, objects have an appearance of being three-dimensional. This is only faked, really. It's using some tricks to trick your brain and your eye into believing these objects are really three-dimensional. In reality, they're just flat polygons on a flat surface. But it uses tricks like specific angles. For example, this looks like a 90-degree angle at first glance. And that's what the program are trying to fool you into thinking, that this is a 90-degree angle. But in reality, it's a 120-degree angle. That's part of how perspective works and tries to trick you with an isometric perspective into believing that this is three-dimensional objects. So, just going in and editing the object is a bit tricky. So, we're going to do this slightly different. We're going to use an effect called a color key to actually remove part of the wall. So let's start by doing that and see how the result works. First of all, when I use the color key, I'm going to draw a polygon in a specific color, and I'm going to tell the effect which color I used for the polygon, and wherever that polygon covers up my sheet, it will be made invisible. So I need to draw this on the same sheet that the wall is on. So let's figure out that first, shall we? Go to Info and List, select the wall, and do it. And I can see it's on the wall's sheet. Okay, let's select the wall's sheet. Okay. The next thing I need to do is to select the color for this polygon. Traditionally, we use some kind of color which is not present in the map normally, because this is going to be invisible. We're not going to see it. So usually this color number 6, this nice little pink, is the default color for this kind of effect. Also need to make sure that I'm using a solid fill style, brush patterns, solid. And that my line width is 0. Now I'm gonna click the fractal polygon, and I'm gonna start drawing my section. Few things to keep in mind here. First of all, turn off snap. You don't want to do that when drawing a freehand fractal path. And I'm going to start my point here behind the wall for the first point. And I'm gonna cross over like this. But before I press the next point, look at the line, the preview. As you can see, the fractalization of this line is quite low for my needs here. I need to increase it. And if you look at the command line, you can see that it offers to change the depth by clicking the left or right arrows. The depth is basically how detailed the fractalization is, and the greater the depth, the more detail. But we need to be a bit careful here. We don't want to go overboard, because if you make the depth too large, you will get a bunch of nodes in your map, more nodes than you really need, and it will really slow down your drawing, and in the worst case can even crash camp and cartographer if you go too far. So basically, increasing it about 5-ish times is usually good enough. Do however notice that when you now click the right arrow key, that camp and cartographer needs just a little bit to pick up that you did that. So if you click 5 times really fast, it's probably not going to notice. So I'm gonna click one at a time, and we can just look a bit at the line. So click once, you can now see it's a bit more detailed. It's now actually 3 nodes between the start node and my cursor. Click again, we'll double it. And now 7 nodes between the cursor and the first point. Third click, it's now 31 nodes. The fourth click, it's now actually 63 nodes, and I think that's more than enough. So notice that if the line is smaller, the nodes will also be close together. The total amount of nodes is the same over the length of the line when we do fractalization. The depth setting really just controls how many nodes will be in each segment, and it doubles each time you hit the button. That's why you have to be careful. Okay, so first I'm gonna place the first segment on the opposite side of the wall, and notice that I'm trying to cross the wall as straight across as possible. This makes our job later much, much simpler. I could of course go at the diagonal like that, but it's much more difficult to give a nice perspective view of it to actually make the lines and such needed. So I'm gonna make it easy on myself, and I'm gonna cross straight over and place my second node there. Now I'm going to draw the ruin section. I don't draw all in one section. You can see I move on smaller sections. And I try to place a node exactly at this corner here. And when I cross the end of the wall, I try to do the same thing as I did up here. I try to cross straight over, with straight in both cases, up here and down here, meaning the direction of the actual wall. And not straight as on straight on my screen, but along the wall like this. Doesn't need to be perfect, but try to keep it close. Done that. I can continue clicking and just right click a couple of times when you're done to complete the polygon. Okay, this defines the shape of my ruined wall. If I don't like it, I should just delete this shape right now and do it again, because changing it later is going to be tricky, because we're going to make copies of this one, and that means you have multiple copies to handle. So I don't want to do that. So now we're gonna make it transparent. Click the sheets and effects. On the wall sheet, I'm gonna add the color key effect. It suggests this color by default, and I'm happy with that. It's the same color I picked, which I drew. Remember, this need to be the exact same color. There is no room for similar color or looks somewhat like that color. If it isn't the exactly same color, then it won't work. So, okay, and okay. There we go. Now, a big section of my wall is missing. And right now, you can see some of the issue with this isometric perspective and trying to fool your brain into thinking this is 3D. Because once I cut away this part of the wall, well, there is no top of the wall going down here. It doesn't really have a thickness. It's just infinitely thin. A lot of things seems to be missing here. And that's because when we draw a perspective wall, only the part needed will be drawn. There isn't some kind of thickness. This isn't a solid object. So when I cut away things like that, I would automatically see the inside and the fill of this solid object. That's not how this works. So I need to draw these things for myself. And that's what we're going to do in the next steps. Okay. So, first of all, we need another sheet to work with. I am going to create a sheet and I'm going to call it Walls Top. And I'm going to make sure it's right below the wall sheet in the list. That means that whatever we draw on this sheet will appear on top of the walls in the final drawing. Now, what I'm going to draw on this Walls Top sheet is basically the new top of the wall, the top of the ruined wall. And to do that, I'm going to use this invisible shape we now have as a guideline to make this top on the wall. So I need to make a copy of this entity. So I'm going to start by placing a copy of it on the wall's top sheet. You remember we draw the invisible entity on the wall sheet. Now I want a copy on the wall's top sheet. You can do that by right-clicking Sheets and Effects and choosing Copy to Sheet. I select my invisible polygon. I know where it is, so it's not that difficult to select, but if you don't find it, you can always just turn on the effect again temporarily to be able to select and copy this sheet. Once I have it selected, I just do it, and I'm being asked which sheet to place it on. Okay, I make sure that the wall's top is the selected sheet, and click OK. Now we have a copy on the wall's top sheet, and since that sheet does not have a color key effect, it will be visible. Now, before we proceed, I'm going to change one little detail about our original invisible object. Because right now, since these two objects precisely overlap, I mean, if I do a list, I have two objects here. I have one on the wall sheet, and if I scroll down, I should find another one on the wall's top sheet. So it's always a risk when I start working now that I'm going to edit the wrong entity, and I don't want to do that. So I'm going to freeze the layer it's on. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, I go back to the wall sheet and I'm going to hide the wall's top sheet. Okay, now we only have the invisible entity. I'm going to click layers and I'm going to add a layer called holes, and I'm going to set this as frozen. Now I'm going to select my invisible entity and I'm going to put it on the holes layer, which is frozen, which means just as we did with the grid earlier, it now can no longer be edited. If I try to delete it, I can select the wall, but I cannot select this invisible entity. And that's fine. That's exactly as we want it. Now I can show the wall's top again. And I have again this nice pink shape. Okay, let's turn it into a line it gets much easier to see what we are doing. So I use change properties on it and do it. And I'm gonna set the color to a nice black, and I'm gonna set fill style to hollow. There we go. This line now forms a nice little outline on this side of the wall, showing a ruined section. But we still need a similar line on the other side of the wall. Basically the same as we have here on the top, giving the wall a thickness. And to do that, I'm going to copy the existing line 2 feet, which is the width of the wall, in this direction. But it's important that I do this precisely. I could just copy and do it by eye, but that won't line up properly. So I need to make sure I use the precision tools. Unfortunately, in Campaign Cartographer, we have the bearing command, which can give us the precise direction of a line. Now, before I do that, we need to talk a little bit about the wall, because if I use info list and I try to select just this line, I'm gonna select the entire wall. I'm gonna do it. And the reason for that is that the wall is a group. It's a group of different entities which is being treated as if they were one entity. This makes sense when we want to use basic operations on the wall, like deleting it or moving it. But right now, I'm very interested in just this line. And if we want to work with groups without them behaving like groups, we can unlock groups by clicking this button down here. It says locked, means groups are locked. Click once, they are now unlocked. I can now more easily go to info, bearing, and I click on this line to select it, and it tells me that the angle for this line is 30 degrees. Okay, fine. So I now know both things I need to know. I know that this line is 2 foot. We did that when we originally drew the wall. We specified it should be 2 feet. I can measure it if I want to, but it should be 2 feet. And I know the angle of this line is 30 degrees. That helps me specify exactly how to copy this. Okay, so to copy it, just right click the copy button and choose non-visual copy. I could use the regular copy too, that works fine, but I don't need to, and I prefer to use non-visual copy. So click on the line to select it again, do it. Now, Campaign Cartographer will ask you for the origin point. Normally, this is quite important because it helps you place the object after copying or placing the copy. But right now, I am going to place it relative to the existing polygon in any case. So it doesn't really matter where I place the origin point. I can place it wherever I want on the entire map. It doesn't make a difference, because once I copy something relative to the origin point, it will also be relative to the entity, no matter where the origin point actually is. So I'm just going to click somewhere randomly and be happy with that. Now, the important thing here is where to copy it to. As you can see, since I use non-visual copy, you cannot see an outline of the entity being dragged around the map. And I'm going to type the coordinates to place it, so I don't really need to see that outline in any case. Now, look down at the command line here, copy to. Now, to copy something in an isometric point of view, we need to use polar coordinates. You might remember polar coordinates from maths class in school. I guess many of you haven't used them at all since then. But they have this great advantage that you can specify something in an angle and a distance. And that's exactly what I want to do. I don't know the exact coordinates I want this shape to end up on, but I know that it should be moved 2 feet in a 30 degree angle from the current location. So to tell campaign cartographer that I'm using polar coordinates, I start with a less than sign, then I type the angle, which is 30, a comma, and the distance, which is the width of my wall, 2 feet, on the command line, and hit enter. There we have a nice copy. I can now right click to finish up, and as you can see, I now have 2 copies of this line, and you can already see the kind of shape that is forming down here. We are already seeing the top of the wall being formed. The next step is to trim these lines. There are a lot of lines there we don't need, so let's remove these additional lines. I like to just do a bit of rough work first, get away the main things I don't need. I'm gonna zoom in here, and I have 2 lines, so I'm gonna use split, and I'm just gonna click and click again, and click and click again. This doesn't do anything visually, but it actually splits the line here. These 2 shapes used to be polygons, but if I do a list on one of them now, they are a part instead, or a line. I'm gonna split them down here as well. Split. And if I now zoom out, you can see that I can erase these lines and only this part will be selected. The rest will be left behind. Now, with the lines trimmed, all we have to do is connect this back line up so it actually connects to the wall, and so we actually get 1 line going all the way around. We're gonna turn that into a polygon, so it's very important to have a single line with no holes. Now, there are a couple of tricks we need to do to make work a little bit easier here. One of the things is that the hole polygon we have in the background is still going to mess some things up for us, because it's on a frozen layer, but it's still there, so it's possible to click on it, and since we can't edit it, that would just cause the command to end in most cases. So I want to get rid of it. And the wall also consists of polygons with shading, which also is a problem when I'm using modifiers, because if the modifiers pick the shade entity instead of the actual entity, it won't really understand it and won't know what to do with it. So I'm gonna go in here, I'm gonna hide my holes for now, which you remember is the layer we placed the polygon on, and I'm gonna also hide the wall's solid colors. That won't hide the top of the wall, but it will hide the side of the wall. So, like this. Now we can see the entire wall again, since we hid the whole polygon. So, just zoom close in here in our workspace. And the first thing I need to do is that I want to connect this rear line up to this point where the front line meets the end of the wall, and I can do that by using the node edit. Select it, you can pick a node, this node, and I want to put it up here. Okay, now I'm going to use the intersection modifier. In this case, it might sometimes be a bit tricky to get the exact entities you need and actually get the modifier working, so sometimes I need a couple of tries. But click intersection, I click the first line, I want to intersect with this line, and I click this line for the second entity. Okay, we can see the node fits perfectly up there on the first try. Good. Right click to end node editing. Okay. Now, we still have some part of the line we don't need anymore. So I'm gonna do a trim, and I'm gonna trim this line, and I'm gonna trim it again where this line and this line intersects. And I'm gonna do the same thing for this line, and I'm gonna do it where this line and this line intersects. And by doing it this way, using the modifiers in Campaign Cartographer, the points where these meet will be perfect. They will meet at the exact same point. It doesn't just look like the same point visually, but it is the exact point. That's important when we're later going to turn this into a polygon. I'm going to do the same thing down here. We have this point here, and we need to see where the front line exits the wall. This is right here, not the back line. So again, I want to use node edit. I'm just going to grab this node, and I want it down here. Let's try the intersection modifier. If we're lucky, we can just click in the intersection. And it just picked up one of them. There we go. Exactly where I wanted it. And we can now trim the lines as above. I'm gonna trim this line to where it intersects with this line. And I'm going to trim this line to where this and this intersects. Okay, I now have two lines. Now, in some cases, using node edit might not have been the best option. It might have been better to draw an extra line in here and connect things manually using that line instead. And if you did that instead of using node edit, make sure that one end of the line then matches up exactly where this line ends, and the other end of the line exactly where this line ends. So again, you would use modifiers in the same way. Don't just draw something by eye and hope it will work, because it probably won't. Okay, I'm gonna turn back on the two layers I hid. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. The wall looks pretty nice already. The only thing missing is we need some kind of fill on the top. To do that, we need to join the lines. And again, this whole polygon might cause an issue. Just let's try to hide it. Could just left it hidden, of course, but the reason why it might cause an issue is again because the edge of it lines up exactly with my line here. These lines might be difficult to see now in the video, dark lines on a dark wall, but you already know where they are. So now I'm going to right click explode and first do a line to path. And I'm going to select both lines. Make sure to not select the wall or any part of the wall or anything else. And if instead of moving the nodes that I did, that you have some extra lines connecting here, make sure to include these lines as well. We need all the lines forming our new shape in one command. I'm just gonna right click and do it. And we can see that the new polygon has formed. Now, if some of your points did not match up perfectly, the next step would be to right click and do a path to poly, and again select the line. Some of them might have already joined up, so it might be fewer lines for the next command. But you just select the lines and you execute the command. But I don't need to do that right now, because it's already formed a polygon. That's only if the first line to path does not form a polygon. You do need to use the path to poly afterwards. But this is fine. I'm going to go back and show my hole again. Perfect! Exactly as I wanted. Now, all I need to do is go in here, change properties on it, and I'm gonna put fill style, and I'm going to put the same one, which is on top here, which should be the stone gray flat P3A. Okay, there we go. And as a final step, I'm gonna use outline in black on this one. Do it. And there we go. One piece of ruined wall ready to use. Now, just to illustrate that the wall works, I can place some symbols behind it. It should be on the symbols lower sheet. And just grab us statues. And here we go. Finish the Shuari draw. And we can see the ruined wall works perfect. If I want to make it more believable or more detailed, I can add in some things. I can see, let's go to the normal symbol sheet and I can put in some rocks, some fallen rocks, fallen from the wall perhaps. We can even put some small rocks on top of the wall. I could also use a fill with a bit more, something that looks more like a broken pattern. If you remember my original map, the one I showed at the beginning of this video, I had used a pattern with more texture in it, which might look more believable as a broken wall. It all depends on how much detail you want to put in it, but as we can see, the shape of the wall is perfect. It really looks like wall where parts of it has fallen out. So we can just go back to the other map just to show what I mean. Lots of effects in this map, so it loads a bit slow, but you can see here I've done the exact same tricks here, but I've used a fill style with a bit more texture to it, looking perhaps a bit more ruined than just the plain fill style. Okay, that's it for this video. Thank you for watching and have a nice day.